Now, what kind of questions or what kind of topics can we address with niche modeling in the context of climate change? As Richard mentioned, there are studies in which you look for forecasting the distributions and others that you go back in time. And there is an important difference between these two approaches. And it's, as Richard mentioned, that for the future we don't have any data to validate our results. So what we get, it's only hypothesis on what can happen in the future. On the other hand, when we project models back in time, we have data to validate this information. So the science that we can get from one study or one type of studies and the other is very different. It's much more solid going to the back. We can learn more from looking at the past than what we can see to the future. So let me show you some examples of how this modeling has been used by different people, including us. Like the very basic ones is just to understand when you handcast the mold, is to understand the responses of species to climatic changes from the past, in the past. So in this case, this was part of my dissertation, my PhD dissertation. We modeled the distribution of 23 mammals. First, we built models in the present and projected them to past conditions and the reverse. To see, the question here was if the species were tracking their niches across space, or if they expanded their distribution, or they shrink their distribution. The general result of this study is that from the 23 mammal species that we were able to get data from, the last glacial maximum and the present, well, comparison in the last climatic change event, is that for most of them, we find a correspondence between the modeled distribution in the present and in the past, with the current records from the present and the fossil records in the past. So this means that species have been able to track the changes in the distribution of their niches. For other six species, results were not quite solid. And for other five species, we find no correspondence between the modeled and the actual distributions to the past and in the present. And that happens that these five species are currently large species, but in the Pleistocene, those species were not the biggest one because the megafauna was present. Those mammoths and saber-toothed and tigers, etc. So what the way we interpret this is that these medium-sized species, the places in which today are large species, found like an ecological release. So they didn't have any predators or competitors of their size, so they could expand across the space. Well, this hand casting has been used also to find or identify Pleistocene refuges. Combining different approaches, in this case paleogeographic techniques with ecological modeling techniques, and see how their conclusions match in terms of the geographic position we have also used phylogenetic information to understand demographic processes and the combination with ecological and niche models. To see, looking at the genetic patterns within a species, and like identifying the genetic structure of populations within species, and then we compare that with allele distributions, we can get insights in what demographic processes have occurred to these species, like bottlenecks for expansion, for example. One of the neatest works that I have seen using ecological niche modeling for handcasting is this one of a friend of us, David Noguez, to explore the two hypotheses behind the extinction of the megafauna, in this case of the mammoth, the woolly mammoth. In one extreme of this debate is that megafauna was driven to extinction by human colonization, and on the other extreme is the people that think that extinction was driven by climatic changes at the end of the Pleistocene, like 10,000 years ago. So what David did in his study was to model the distribution of the mammoth using fossil records for different periods in time, in the last glacial maximum and in the last interglacial, and different periods in the last glacial maximum, to see if the distribution tended to shrink during the warming period and to expand during the cold periods of this cold warm periods of the places. And what his results gave to him is this line here represents the expansion of the first humans arriving to northern Europe. So what he observed is that in warm periods the distribution of the mammoth was reduced and expanded during the cold periods, and in the last warming process 10,000 years ago, when it was finished 10,000 years ago, humans already arrived to the very north of the continent. So it doesn't resolve the debate between which of the two drivers might have created the extinction demand, but it was probably the combination of two. Populations were naturally depleted by this warming process, and humans came into play in this process and ended up with the extinction of the species. This is a pretty neat thing that you have in your package. Then we have this other bulk of studies that project models to the future instead of going to the past. And in this case, there are literally hundreds, if not thousands, of papers on modeling one species, a set of species, with different aims at the end. This is one of the pioneer studies made by Town, and in which they model whole biotopes in Mexico, the whole species of mammals, birds, and two whole families of butterflies, with the idea of taking patterns of here extinction, turnovers, colonization, etc. Then there have also a bunch of studies on using projections to the future for conservation purposes, like Richard was mentioning, for this field of conservation planning. There have been efforts from different groups on projecting models to the future to see if, for example, current protected areas networks are useful for future patterns of distribution of biodiversity. And you can find all sorts of studies on projecting to the future there is a dark side in this part of the studies, which is called uncertainty. The problem with the models to the future, particularly to the future, is that, that we have several sources of uncertainties, starting with uncertainties on how the climate is going to be. We have the same situation to the past, that we didn't have good climatic models for the past, and we didn't have fine resolution models for the past. And also the fossil record, you know, has a lot of problems in terms of representation, in terms of good geographic distributions of the species from the fossil records, in terms of dating. So one main issue here is the uncertainty on the climatic variables. It is like a common practice to run models under different climatic scenarios. There are hundreds of scenarios out there for the future, and much less for the past, but there are also several scenarios from the past. So you run models for several scenarios, and then as Richard mentioned 2 days ago, there are techniques for consensing all these models. But still, what you get is an analysis of the uncertainty associated to this type of studies. There is also algorithmic uncertainty. Richard 3 days ago mentioned this study that he led, in which we compared the distribution of species of the South African plant species under different under the same conditions. We projected the niche model to the same, exactly the same scenarios, using different algorithms, 9 different algorithms, which are quite good. And these are the results. You can see that for some algorithms, the distribution will expand, and for others would collapse, basically. What this study taught us was that the fate of a species depends on the modeling method you are using, which is pretty risky. And trying to understand why this happens, why the methods perform so differently when we project them to future conditions, because that didn't happen for the current conditions. All these methods did a good job at modeling the current distribution. The problem was when we projected them to different scenarios. And it has to do with how do each one of these algorithms deals with environmental combinations that don't find in the calibration scenario, and you find them in the projected scenario. When you have novel environments, some of the algorithms would extrapolate, some others would truncate, some others would plan. So each one takes a different decision on how to manage these novel environments. So this causes these huge differences among them. And this is a big problem. How can we know which of these algorithms is doing a good job? There is no way to do that for the future, because we don't have data to test what is the truth. What we are doing in my lab with a student of mine and Richard is that she developed environmental services for Mexico for the 20th century, So we have occurrence data for birds, for herbs, and for mammals for the beginning of the 20th century and all along the 20th century. So we are using historic data with historic environmental layers to project them onto current environmental layers, and with current occurrence data, see which of these algorithms, which of the algorithms perform better. In that way, we can see, we can have like an idea of which of